Everyone, we do have a mic that's hot. So while we're starting, we're trying to get the microphones going for our panelists here, but maybe we'll get started. Hi, while you're finding your seats. So this is one of the library panels during the CENIC conference. There will be two. I encourage you to attend the session tomorrow. I think it's at 11, is it? Yeah. So today we have a couple of representative libraries from year two. My name is Paula MacKinnon. I'm the interim director with Califa. We are the aggregator for the State Library and for CENIC for the library program. So we've been involved with the program from the beginning, and we're currently in year three, so we're now signing up new libraries and doing contracts. And our representatives here are from year two, so they have just gotten connected. And if get confirmation that our mics are working, do you want to try it?
Can you hear me?
Can you hear me?
There we go.
There you go.
So we have here today Susan Broman at the end from Los Angeles Public Library, Director of Emerging Technologies and Collections. I think Los Angeles Public Library is the first library in the nation to be connected at 100 gigabytes. So that's 100 gigabytes. So they just got connected in November, I think it was?
November.
And they went from 1 gig to 100 gigabytes. And we have Misty Jones, who is the director of San Diego Public Library, local. And they went from 500 megabytes to a gigabyte. They went live, I think, in September, October, right? And we were hoping to have Sarah Houghton here, director of San Rafael Public Library, but she is out ill. So I will fill in for her where possible. There are large shoes to fill. And actually, they haven't gone live yet. They're going live this week. So they have some interesting stories about programs that they've tried that really could have used a gigabit. And then we have Susan Hildreth, who is currently the professor of practice at the University of Washington iSchool. She's formerly the director of Califa, formerly the director of IMLS, formerly the state librarian of California, formerly the city librarian of Seattle and San Francisco, and the ALA treasurer. So she's a bit of a rock star here on our panel. So I thought to start, we would start with Susan, because actually this time last year, she was the executive director of Califa, and she was helping recruit our year two libraries. And so all of these people that are libraries that are getting connected now, she was intimately involved in bringing them on board. So Susan.
Okay. Well, okay, this is a pretty tight mic here, huh? All right. Well, good afternoon, everybody, and we're so glad that you're here with us today. And we know we have some library folks out there. So hi, library folks. It's great to see you here. Yay, at the CENIC conference. Awesome. But we also know we have some other folks with us who are great colleagues. And we thought one of the things we wanted to do is just do a brief history of how we got to where we are today. So I'm going to do that as briefly as possible, because we really want to talk about all the neat stuff we can do now that we have this great connectivity. But it has been a bit of a journey to get to where we are. And, you know, when we think about the background and history of public libraries and public access computing, it's really all about providing equitable access to information. And public libraries have been doing that for a number of years, really since our inception in the 1800s. That's what we've been there for. And I think we've always been, in some cases, early adapters. There's always been a few of us who are really willing to try new things and then bring some of our colleagues along. But just, and all of you may be familiar with this, depending on how long you've been working in this, in the IT and information and education world, but libraries really embraced technology and automation in the 1970s as we moved to online catalogs and automated circulation control. And then, you know, our access, providing access to the internet, really started maybe in the late 1980s, early 1990s. And that initiative was jump-started by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation's first grants, and these were the first grants that the Gates Foundation ever gave, was to support public access computing in public libraries. They made their first grants in 1997, Their focus was really on rural and under-resourced communities, and they wanted to give all people ready access to information and the opportunities that come with digital skills and connectivity. That's still what we're doing today. There was a tremendous adoption of public access computing in libraries. In 1994, we have the figure of 21% of public libraries providing access to the internet, which I think might be a little high, but I found this in a reputable journal. And then moving on to 2009, 25 years beyond, 99% of libraries provided access to the internet. So that's a 78% increase in 20 years. So we really got going there. But of course, along with access came many challenges. Electrical infrastructure, purchasing equipment and replacing it regularly, cost and capacity of internet access, which was a huge challenge. Policies and procedures to manage our extensive demand for those services. So something that I wanted to mention that I think most of us are familiar with, and when we were here initially today and saw the great survey of 20 years of CENIC's history, starting off with 1997, the late 1990s was an amazing time because the Telecommunications Act was passed in 1996, and that established the Education Rate Program that provides subsidized access to the internet for schools and for libraries. So now, interestingly enough, 1996, in 2000, legislation was passed called the Children's Internet Protection Act, which really talks about requiring restrictions for internet safety policies and technology that block access to the internet or filtering certain material from being accessed through the internet. So the Children's Internet Protection Act, some of you may know that by its acronym CIPA. It was challenging, and the American Library Association fought the Children's Internet Protection Act, CIPA, because particularly in our public libraries, and not necessarily so in our schools, but in public libraries, unfiltered access to the internet is one of our key priorities. But that fight was not successful, and the CIPA had to be applied to any libraries receiving E-rate by 2004. So many libraries declined to filter, and they did not receive the E-rate. So one of the great features of CENIC connectivity is that access to our backbone telecom infrastructure through CENIC is not subject to the CIPA requirements. So many more California libraries are now participating as in the CENIC network and participating in the E-rate program through CENIC's consortial application. This is a huge difference for us in California. So, again, of course, when CENIC kicked off in 1996 and 1997, we know that our original charter associates were from the higher ed community, and as we saw this morning in 2004-2005, CENIC began connecting the K-12 community, and that was a fascinating story this morning in the video about who knew who talked to who at the governor's office to make that happen. That was awesome. But at that time, I was serving as the California State Librarian. And I can remember having a great visit with then-CEO Jim Delgonis in the State Librarian's magnificent office. If you haven't been to Sacramento and dropped by that office, everybody should do it because it's a state treasure. But anyway, even though we were in a grandiose office, I could not convince Jim that it was time to bring public libraries on board. And it was understandable. I mean, that school project took a long time. It was a major effort. And it started to pave the way, though, I think, for libraries. So once again, the Gates Foundation stepped into the fray. They recognized the challenge of robust broadband connectivity to libraries, and they sponsored summits in 7 states to really bring broadband connectivity for libraries to the forefront in the state. And those summits included Texas, New York, and California, and other states as well. So the California State Library assembled nearly 200 public library leaders, community supporters, broadband providers, and other local and state leaders for California's Opportunity Online Broadband Summit. Now that happened in December 2009. And it really got the attention, I think, of our state and local leaders in terms of how important it is to have great broadband capacity to our public libraries. So it really started our great project and initiative here in motion. After much research and planning, the FY 2014-15 state library budget contained over $2 million in annual appropriations to support public library connectivity to CalREN. So we're really excited to report that with our new participants in 2017, we have 75% of the public library jurisdictions connected or going to be connected. And we know that's a process to get connected, but they're ready to go. They've committed. And we have over 47% of our branches connected. So, you know, we have it's been a great journey. And I personally am so proud to be here to acknowledge the progress we've made. But we've really been focusing on the gear and the wires and the connecting and all that techie stuff, which is really, really important. But when you think about the exposure and the audiences in public libraries, now is the time for us to take this capacity and really make a huge difference in public programming. And that's what the rest of our panelists are going to talk about. But particularly for those of you who might not have lived through these struggles, we wanted you to know that libraries have been working on this public access connectivity and broadband for many years, and we're really proud and pleased to be part of the CENIC family.
And I think the State Library actually just started doing a survey of year one libraries that have been connected for a year. So this is going to be a rolling survey that will go out to each library as they reach that one-year mark. So we can get feedback from them on what it is that they have been doing. I think it was very anticipatory as libraries were looking at getting connected, not really sure what it was or how we were going to use it until they saw it in action. So just from the survey, I just wanted to highlight some of the information that's been coming in. One of the things that we hear basically from 100% of the libraries is that the complaints have gone away. And so people who are coming in to use Wi-Fi or the internet, they're no longer complaining that they can't get to something or something is downloading or, things are timing out. It's just stopped. It just went away. It wasn't like somebody said, oh, this is great. They just stopped. So that was huge. Freeze staff up to actually do their jobs and things. So in addition to the Wi-Fi, there was an expectation maybe that there would be more people coming in to use the PCs. And that's actually not the case, because what's happening is that more people are using their devices and using the Wi-Fi. So there's been a significant increase in the number of people that are coming in to make use of the library Wi-Fi, because it's no longer just good enough. It's, it's office ready. So that's been another pleasant surprise. New programs, libraries have been able to start looking at maybe streaming things. I think people are just trying things on now to see, how is it that I can make use of this in a way that wasn't possible to me before. So there's all kinds of really interesting ideas that are coming up and being tried and hopefully shared. And I think you'll hear more of these too with the session tomorrow. There's been a couple of interesting things that came up as well, where libraries said, now I actually have to deal with piracy issues, and people are making great use of this fantastic network to maybe not do things that they should be doing. So that was a bit of a learning curve too. So maybe I'll hand it over to Misty to give you some idea of what's been happening at San Diego Public. Like I said, they've just been connected since September.
Yeah.
So still getting used to it, but a significant change going from 500 megabytes to 1 gig.
Yes, absolutely. So I'll start by telling you a little bit about San Diego Public. So we have a new central library downtown San Diego. It opened in September of 2013. It is significantly larger than our old one. We went from 150,000 square feet to 500,000 square feet. It is 9 stories and has a high school, a charter high school inside the library on 2 floors with 500 wow. students. So was immediately when we moved in, we knew it was not going to be business as usual, right? So like Paula said, we started out with 500 megabytes and initially, really saw some issues. And so connecting in September and moving up to 1 gig has just changed the playing field for us. And one of the things that we noticed, things that we would have never even attempted to do before, in just some of the strains, I think that you probably are all familiar, just strains on your network. And of course, ours is having an additional 500 people in the building at all time, even though they have their own network, they somehow are able to creep into ours because ours is not filtered like theirs is. So to have an extra 500 students on your network every day can be a drain, but we haven't seen that since September. Wow. So that's been really an interesting, revelation for us. Just some of the things, we have over 300 devices in the library. As we're seeing more and more people bringing in their own devices and not just using the computers, the desktop computers that we have, but bringing in their own. We get about 3,500 people a day, every day in the library. And the first thing I can tell you, the first place they go is the computers. So they are used all day long from the time we open to the time we close. And like Paula said, the complaints are gone. No longer is there, this movie keeps buffering and buffering and buffering. It just went away. I would have liked for them to say, what did you do? This is great. You made it so much better. But no, they didn't. It just took oh, great. Now it works. Complaints are gone, which, Susan and I were talking about earlier. Job satisfaction for librarians has gone through the roof because of that. You don't have to be the bearer of bad news every day. We're also able to do things like video conferencing. And who would have thought that we ever would be able to have an actual Skype interview process where, when we're doing interviews, San Diego sometimes is not the best, easiest place to fly into for a job interview. But we're able to do Skype interviews. We use a lot of our study rooms for co-working spaces, so people are able to come in and do video conferencing and have their own kind of co-working events with colleagues from different areas because our internet is so much faster than what they have at home. One of the trends that we're seeing is more and more streaming of movies and such, and less. It used to be where people would check out a DVD and then they would go to the computer, put the DVD in, and play the DVD. Now we've seen DVD checkouts just drop considerably because they stream. So that's what they do. They come in and they stream movies. Every single day if you walk through, you just see videos playing. And to have 300 devices with probably half of them streaming something and it not crash your system is huge. And I would have never thought 3 years ago that it would even be possible. We have a homework program, an after-school homework program, where we have between 50 and 70 kids every day after school that have their own devices or are also using online resources after school in addition to the other people that are on the computer. We have done Day of Code, which we would have never attempted before. In November, we did a Day of Code. We had 150 students for 24 hours in the library, 24 hours wow. Coding. We've done an augmented reality project that we did in conjunction with the high school where we developed an augmented reality project that surrounds, if you've ever been to the downtown library, we have a very large dome on top of the library that's kind of a very unique architectural feature and really has a lot of, kind of the STEM theories behind it and constructing it. And so we did a complete project surrounding that. And you can, kids were able, you have 40 kids with personal devices able to experience this all at the same time. So Comic-Con, we are finally Comic-Con headquarters in San Diego. We have just this past year been added to the Comic-Con campus.
Oh, wow.
And so they use the library for panel discussions and for different presentations. And then next year, because they were able to do all of the things that they wanted to do this year, they're going to even expand it to have, last year was the educational aspect, and so this year they're going to really expand that and take over the entire library for the entire duration of Comic-Con. So it's very cool. Which, if you've ever been to Comic-Con and tried to use your device at the conference, impossible. So they like coming to the library for that.
We just in the past, you did some like companion programs. And
yes.
Comic-Con was going on, and then in the library, you would
we kind of did our own little
right.
thing. So we have always had a...
So now you're integrated.
Yeah, so now we're integrated. So an official
right.
part of the campus. So that's pretty cool. You wouldn't get that if you didn't have the resources necessary for them.
It's a pretty valuable library
yeah.
card.
And then last year was the first year that we did this in the fall, and they want to do it again as the Wiki Conference.
Mm.
So the Wikimedia had their big 3-day-long Wiki Conference there. And I almost was, when I was writing it down, I almost put WikiLeaks because I've been watching Testimony all day. So I was like, nope, not that conference. But but we would have the bandwidth to do that too. So, but like I said, I mean, it really has kind of changed the game for us and being able to really think beyond what we ever would thought we could accomplish before. Our next step is connecting the 35 branches that we have, so that's kind of our year 3 plan to start connecting our branches and really get them up to that speed as well. And I want to hear what the 100 gig library
so
can
everyone
do.
Everyone is looking to LIPL. Yeah. Like, I know you've only been connected since November, but... It's
yeah.
still such an awesome like achievement, and we're kind of looking to see what is going to happen.
It is a pretty amazing to have that level of connectivity. So for those of you who aren't familiar with LAPL, just a little bit of background. We have a big central library downtown, and then 72 branches throughout the city. And they span from some of the wealthiest places, you know, the most expensive places to live in the country, to, you know, Hollywood, creative areas, and, you know, to South LA and other economically challenged areas. Huge number of languages being spoken in our communities, and just incredibly diverse across the board. So, yeah, so we in fact, just this whole thing started just a little over a year ago,
mm-hmm.
and, well, actually, well before that as well. But we kind of had this sweet spot of our library director, John Zabo, who really gets it. He understands the importance of investing in infrastructure. We had a really excellent budget year, which is such an incredible thing to be able to say, where we were able to kind of take this big step and connect at 100 G. And it has been kind of amazing. We had a big test of this back in January of 2000. Or January of this year, January 21st, the day of the Women's March. There were somewhere between 300 and reports are varying between 300 and 700,000 people in downtown Los Angeles, many of who came by the library and used our Wi-Fi, and it was solid as rock. It was amazing. And that's one of the few times I have had staff who said, I can't believe it worked the whole day. and we're so thrilled because, yeah, that you were talking about, the complaints just stopped, and complaining about videos not buffering, about not being able to connect, just gone. And a lot of our staff, you know, that cost is, you know, well justified just to get that. So we're really now in the process of exploring some of the things that we can do with this connection. And some of the things that we are planning to do. So right now we are working on, as we speak actually, connecting our branches. So every branch will have 100 gig up from 40 megabytes right now. Each branch will have a 1 gig connection. Yeah, oh, that would be insane, right?
I'm moving to Los Angeles.
Everybody's moving to LA. so every branch will have 1 gig. What this is going to allow us to do is to be able to virtualize our PC, public access PCs, so that we can extend the life of our equipment, push out changes a lot faster. We think this is going to be really a huge, game-changing for us. We're also realized that we're kind of playing with this, and we're realizing that we can do a lot of we're planning to do all of our backing up of network drives from the branches back to library headquarters, so that again, saving money on equipment at 72 different locations. We're really excited about moving into a virtual reality project that we're going to set up kind of a little VR center at Central Library, something that, yeah, we just would not have been able to do with our previous access, as well as supporting the large number of initiatives that we have. And so one of the a couple of the things that we're moving, doing more and more of, We have a program called The Source, and that is aimed at people who are in homelessness, come to the library, and it's a one-stop shop for services. So they can sign up for and get an ID card from the DMV. They can get signed up for the coordinated entry system, which is a way to get people into housing, because the philosophy in Los Angeles, as in many cities, to help people in homelessness is housing first. So they can get put into that system. They can get connected with mental health services. They can get all these things that they might have to go all over the city to do in one place. And this connection is allowing us to automate a lot of those systems. So we are helping to support our partners with computer equipment. We're doing intake into our system with tablets and laptops to really kind of capture a lot of the data and information about how to better serve this community. So that's been super helpful. We have done, like Misty, really doing a lot more with teleconferencing and virtual meetings, allowing our staff to not have to drive from the San Fernando Valley into downtown Los Angeles for a meeting. Those of you who have done that before know that's a nightmare. And so, and pay, however much for parking. So we're a lot better. And once we get those connections out to the branches, that should be even better. And then we're exploring partnerships with other organizations in our area. We're talking to some of the Silicon Beach companies like YouTube and maybe some of you here to really kind of bring bringing the access to those experiences to people throughout the city of Los Angeles who won't have that opportunity in other locations. In many of our communities, they're ages away from being able to go somewhere and experience virtual reality. And we feel so strongly that the library is a place to really equalize that throughout the city and give the kids, in Watts the same experience as the kids at the Brentwood Library have, and be able to participate in STEAM programs and get their hands on things that there's not another place for them to do that isn't trying to sell it to them. We do a lot of STEAM programming. We did our first mini maker fair in December of this year, and we're going to be expanding that out in next year as well. So we're just really kind of playing with what we can do with this, seeing what's going to happen next.
Very cool. I know I've mentioned this to you before, but I'm going to tell you my idea again. So when I heard about LAPL going with a 100 megabyte gigabyte connection, I thought, oh, wow, you could live stream to the space station. who's going to make that happen? NASA?
And one of the things we are also going to be able to do is we have a really robust programming through our foundation and through our librarians, so that we're going to start live streaming that out as well, which we really didn't have the capability of doing. So
Susan had also mentioned a virtual reality project, and Sarah Houghton from San Rafael was involved with a pilot that we did, Califa in partnership with the State Library, a small pilot in Marin County where virtual reality stations, like installations, were set up in several of the branches. So these were like 10 by 10 situations where sensors are set up. There's Oculus Rift and HTC Vive and all of the gear required in the high graphic computers to, and a lot of educational content that is being made available for free is loaded onto the machines and accessible, like, you know, a catalog of virtual library programs that one can make use of. It's been super popular to the point where the State Library is extending that program to launch a grant where they want to get virtual reality installations into 100 libraries throughout the state. So this CENIC broadband connectivity program is really going to help with that kind of thing, because what they learned in Marin was this was something that they tried before they had their 1 gigabit connection, and what they had was a 20 megabyte connection. And while the stuff that's loaded on your PC and all of that programming works fine as when it's local, anytime they wanted to download or interact or anything that was in real time, it just didn't work. So I think it'll extend the legs of that kind of programming in libraries where all of that will be possible, and hopefully we can expand the program into actually having people learn to create virtual reality programs. So I'm really looking forward to that. California Libraries, there will be an application that will be going out in the coming weeks where you can apply to be part of that project. We are partnering with Facebook on this. They've been very generous in donating a lot of the Oculus Rift gear and a lot of programs that we can load onto the system. So it's been a new and novel partnership that has happened. It's not really, that's the first time that Califa went to Facebook to have a meeting, so that was really fun. Also, I think something that maybe we haven't mentioned too is the shocking cost of this. It is not shockingly high. You know, when one thinks of going from 20 megabytes to a gigabyte, or from a gigabyte to 100 gigabytes, it's one thinks, well, you're going to double at least or something. And it's turning out that some, you know, after the E-rate discount, the cost is either less than what they were paying or nominal. You know, some libraries are going from $800 a month to $39 a month, or, you know, from $3,000 to $1,000. Yeah.
We went from, what did we go from? We went from $70,000 a year to $1,800 a year.
That is crazy. Yeah.
And that's always helpful when you're going into budget season.
Right.
Yeah.
But when you're talking about all of these wonderful things that one's able to do with this connectivity, it's really important that people recognize that the cost savings are tremendous.
And yeah, and for Los Angeles, Susan was talking about the E-rate earlier, and we did not qualify for E-rate previously. I think our costs are like 10% what they were on an ongoing basis. Mm-hmm. You know, it costs quite a bit to invest in the equipment to get us to the point where we could manage the 100 gig. But it's we think of it as future-proofing the library.
Right.
Like, we're really opening ourselves up for expansion and opportunity. And yeah, we got our first bill for our internet access, and we were just laughing. We're like, I can't even believe that we have this huge pipeline for this cost. It's astonishing.
So something that I just wanted to mention that I noticed while I was more intimately involved in the project and even now is that depending on the configuration in the library situation, in some cases the county or the city really wants to continue to maintain the communication with the city or the county on their network, mm-hmm. which you understand that, and then the library, of course, is providing access to the public through the CENIC network. But it's astounding to me that we're getting to the point in many places, and maybe this is theoretically the way it should be, is that the public has far better access to connectivity and information than the staff does through their staff connections. And I just don't know, I mean, I can't imagine at some point that that's going to, somebody's going to question that. Like, can I have a, why can't we at the staff level have as good connection? It's just interesting to see that happening. And really, it makes such a difference. And I think the other thing that everyone has mentioned here that really is challenging in a way is that, you know, we lived for so many years in public libraries with complaints about lack of, you know, access to capacity, downloading, also just managing the demand on this resource was an amazing workload. And the fact that that's not there, it is great, and it's making the lives of our library staff better. But in a way, you know, just reducing complaints is great internally, but how is that message getting out there? And I guess a question I have for my fellow panelists and other folks too, it, do you think that your policymakers, your board members, your city council, board of supes, do you think they understand the significance of this, or it's going to take a little while for that to happen? Because we really want that message to get out there. Is that happening at all?
Yeah, we are starting to get that message out there, certainly. And we are now in a situation where the connection at Central is so much higher that I have, you know, people who say, oh, I wait to download a book until I'm at the library because it downloads so much better. So, but I think that is a really important message. And part of that is that this is such a basic part of, this is a core service that we provide as a public library. It's not just access, but how to use that access, how to use your device, how to get the most out of your device, how to, you know, like most libraries, our use of e-media has skyrocketed over the last 3 years at a rate of about 20% growth a year. And a lot of that is, you know, commuters who discover we have downloadable audiobooks, which, you know, of course we have a lot in Los Angeles, but also as people just, you know, have the handheld device, want to get the most out of it, don't have access to steady broadband at home, and teaching them, you know, as they come in the library, now they can actually download it in the library as we're teaching them, which was not possible before. Yeah.
I think, so go ahead.
I was going to say the one thing that we did go to the mayor and his staff ahead of, and we had gone the year before to ask for an increase in our budget to increase the speed of the internet. And then when we joined the CENIC, it was, we were able to go and say, hey, we're going to save this much money, but will you invest in the, you know, the equipment and the infrastructure so that we're able to support that? And it was a no-brainer for them. So
I think, like Susan had said at the outset, that this is, even though we're in year three of the project and you know, embarking on hopefully a year four, it's still early days for libraries, and that all of the hard part of getting connected and getting all of the equipment and herding all of the cats has happened. And so once the connectivity is actually happening, now libraries are starting to look at what the opportunities are. And it really is, you can't put too fine a point on the game changer that this is. It's really not a difference of degree. You don't have faster internet. It's a difference of kind. This is, you know, leveling the playing field so that it's not good enough, you know, internet access for people who may not be able to afford it at home. This is equal access. So, you know, this is something that libraries have been proponents of since the dawn of time, and intellectual freedom and all of that. And this is removing the friction, you know. So I will open it up to the audience if you have any questions. Sure.
So now that you have connectivity and we're closing that gap to the library, what about into the community spaces for your mission?
So the question was, now that the libraries are being connected, what about extending that into the communities? And I can say that there are some library projects afoot that are making use of TV white space. So there's one, San Jose State University has an IMLS grant now where they're working with several other organizations and opening up a couple of mini grants for libraries who have the best ideas for making use of the extending, you know, their Wi-Fi access into the community. And so what this does is enables them to take advantage of this high-speed connectivity that they have now, and then using the TV white space to be, you know, miles into the community where people are able to access the library Wi-Fi, but way beyond the walls. So rather than sitting on the front steps at 8 o'clock at night after the library is closed to make use of the Wi-Fi, you can do it anywhere you want. You don't have to go to the coffee shop or anything like that. So there are, like, there are steps being made to start those projects, and I think they're also mission critical in making the library a visible sort of anchor in the community, where it's not just when bad things happen you can go to the library and still get access or something like that, but just a constant reminder that anywhere you go, it's like, oh, there's free Wi-Fi provided by the library, and I have no idea where the library building is.
Mm-hmm. So another thing that I've seen happen over the last several years is that by libraries, public libraries becoming a part of the CENIC team, shall we say, we see synergies between higher ed, K-12, community colleges, public libraries, particularly in terms of trying to serve some of our areas that are very hard to reach or that we haven't had strong connectivity, which ultimately will impact the community, not so much community organizations, but by having the various sectors discussing things at the same table, there are great opportunities for some of our communities that have virtually, you know, very little capacity, and they're not going to get a lot of private providers in there. By working together with the various segments, we think we're going to be able to make some progress in getting better connectivity for some of our poorly connected communities.
So the question is, now that you have all of this bandwidth, have you thought about ways of using virtual or augmented reality to bring people back into the library and to, what was it? Back into the stacks?
Back into the stacks.
I think it's actually a burgeoning area for libraries. We have not been involved in curating virtual reality or augmented reality content because we haven't had the capacity to deliver it. And now that there is that capacity, it's like, you know, we started with books, then we went to DVDs and you know, books on tape, and all of the technologies that came along, we adopted as soon as we were able to deliver them within the library. And so now I think this is the next step. It's all of this crazy fun educational programming. I mean, virtual reality is not just shoot 'em up games. You know, it's exploring the circulation system. It's really crazy. I've tried a couple of these on, and once you put on one of these headsets that are just completely, you know, you've shut the rest of the world out, and your new world is now what it is that's in front of you. And what? Right.
I see that as the most powerful tool to pull people into a library. The library is a physical venue that has all kinds of things that could be mount points for augmented reality demonstrations.
And our augmented reality project did just that. So what we did was, it's kind of a, it's five different sections, and it's an educational program. So at the end of each section, there's a quiz. And it requires you to go and look at certain materials and offers resources in order for you to be able to answer the questions of the quiz. And then there's a really cool, if you get through the entire thing, then you actually can take a picture of yourself sitting on the dome. So that's really, you know, so it's kind of, you know, it's led, but it was strictly educational. And what's interesting is that the students in the high school helped develop the curriculum, and so it fits in with their curriculum that they're learning in class. And we did that for a specific reason, and they're helping us to develop the next augmented reality program.
So I have a question.
Okay. Great, thank you.
And one thing that this will allow us to do is to really expand what we make available both via augmented reality. So our library has an augmented reality app right now. It's actually several years old. And with this technology, we're going to look at expanding that. And what the one we have now does is you can go around the library. Our library, the old part of the library was built in 1924, and there are all kinds of, there's Greek sayings, there's things in Latin, all over the building. It's just like this treasure trove of things that were very popular during the 20s. And so you can take the app and get those translated. And so that's one of the things that we're going to look at expanding. We also want to be able to give people a more in-depth look at some of the special collections that we have, things that are too fragile or too valuable to actually pull out of their storage, but to give people the ability to, you know, flip through, our fourth Shakespeare folio, and some things like that as well. So, there are a lot of crossover. And then more and more, we have a lot of library patrons who don't actually come to the physical library, but they are library users. And they are they're checking out ebooks and audiobooks, music, movies, newspapers, magazines, all through our website. And again, in order to access a lot of that, you need that accessibility at home. And if you don't have that, we don't want that to be a closed door for people in communities. And so we want them to be able to access those things as well on their handheld device. And again, that's something that they'll then be able to come into the library and have access to.
What's a realistic timeline where I can go from decision to implementation?
Are you talking about the program or getting involved in CENIC?
Getting off
CENIC. Oh, okay. Paula, why don't you take that one?
I would say a year.
Yeah.
Really, I mean, Susan is a good example. She said it's been about a year.
It's been almost it's been exactly a year that we started talking about it.
Right.
About now, yeah.
There's a lot of moving parts in the process, and
yeah.
Right.
Yes. Ours went pretty quickly.
Yeah.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Right, and we are looking at areas now where it's monetarily not possible for them to connect on their own. So trying to find ways that we can get fiber into those communities that where the school isn't connected, the library is not connected.
And where is that
at? Well, there are several counties that I can think of that is the situation because they are so remote and it is difficult to get to lay the groundwork to get. We have gone out to get bids for some of these counties, and the cost is exorbitant.
So just to clarify, though, we work closely with CENIC, our CENIC partners in this process. So when we talk about year one, year two, year three, we have a process where libraries who are interested will provide CENIC, Califa, with a letter of intent, and then we work through CENIC with identifying what kind of connections they need. And also CENIC, on our behalf, does an RFP for the various libraries that are interested. So all these services are competitively bid. If you're representing a community that isn't involved, just feel free to talk to us. us, but we have a very collegial integrated process with CENIC in terms of identifying how we can provide the best service to these libraries, and then our CENIC partners help us in terms of giving them options or the best option for connectivity. I mean, often we'll have one option, sometimes a couple, and in some of these really hard to reach places that we're talking about, we may not get any bids at all, but usually we get one or two bids that CENIC helps us really do great analysis of to provide the best the best connection at the best cost for the library.
Any other
gentleman
sure.
had a question?
Will all the libraries now connect to some capacity CENIC connections? Do you see any synergies, let's say between LA and San Diego, or somebody's doing something, maybe share resources? Can you talk a little bit about that and what the barriers could be to that?
That's so the virtual reality project, this expanded project to 100 libraries, this is an attempt to get everyone a starter set, basically. So get everyone up to speed within the same time frame so that librarians are learning about the technology and how to there aren't any best practices for VR in libraries yet. So getting everybody on board at the same time certainly helps with then these projects showing up at conferences and where people can share what it is that they're doing and how other libraries can get involved.
Just another suggestion, as more and more libraries become part of the CENIC network, we also were talking with some of our great CENIC partners about the concept of a CENIC channel where, let's say, LAPL does connect with NASA or San Diego connects with NOAA or something like that. Could we figure out a way to broadcast that great programming so some of our other libraries that are CENIC members that have connection could chime in and we could really not have to, I mean, it's great to have diverse programming all over the state, but the more we could make it available to other partner libraries in the CENIC network as well as other CENIC partners would be great and something that we'll be pursuing in the future.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we're excited to start with, sharing resources just among our own branches and then moving out to other libraries and other CENIC partners is something we're very much looking forward to exploring. Yeah.
I will say, too, that on the sharing, just as IMLS, the Institute for Museum and Library Services, has been in the news lately as something that potentially will be dropped from the budget, IMLS and the funding that is the grants states funding that comes from IMLS to all 50 states to provide funds for grant projects have been super helpful in getting some of these innovative projects going, and it would be a real loss if that indeed does go away. These grant projects have fostered over the last couple of years a great ability for libraries to share amongst each other. So four states might go together on a particular mm-hmm. IMLS grant, or four libraries within a state may partner together on a grant where the end result is meant to be something that they can demonstrate can be shared among this number of libraries and can be extrapolated to the rest. So it's no longer a situation of libraries going to get grants to improve my situation, but working together to try to float all boats.
I think that's yeah, one more, and that's.
Hi, you're all nationally known librarians, and you must have a great perspective on innovations around the country. Could each of you name one thing you've seen enabled in another library by high-speed broadband that you'd love to replicate in your own library?
Hmm.
I have heard from several libraries that have been connected over the past year that they're all making forays into, you know, doing live stream programming with authors. So something that was not possible to pay for and have an author come to your library to do a thing, you can do it wherever they are, and it's a lot more either affordable. And there's been a lot of authors that have opened themselves up to this and are doing making themselves available for more of this kind of programming, where it's onerous on them and their time as well to be able to get to as many libraries as they can. I think recently, just in California, there was Michael Weir and several others have done some live streaming author talks in some of our CENIC libraries.
And something that we piloted with one of the other great CENIC partners, SF Jazz, if they're here, in the libraries in the Bay Area, which is something that would be great to replicate. SF Jazz, we were able to live stream a live performance into libraries and have you know, a question and answer session with the folks in the libraries, with the performers. It was really an absolutely exciting event. It took a lot of coordination on both ends. And I think the more we become comfortable with really pushing the envelope a little bit on this, the better we can do. But, you know, live streaming, tremendous jazz, and all other kinds of cultural activities in CENIC partner entities is another really great activity to consider.
And I think in the coming year, we're probably going to discover some new programming that we haven't even thought of yet, because really a major opportunity right now is for libraries to develop new partnerships within their own communities with organizations that maybe they didn't see a connection with before, and something that they can mutually deliver, either because the library is now a space where they can deliver this kind of thing, or you know, or it's something that they can do that just they haven't thought of before. So I'm looking forward to some new partnerships that will happen.
You want to add, Misty? Yeah, and then Susan.
The one thing that I really want to do is be able to have kind of staff meetings virtually. That's the one key, you know, so that everybody doesn't have to drive to one location. So we can do that virtually, but. There is a library, I think it's Chattanooga Public, and they are a gigabit city. But they have in the library are able to actually students can go in and manipulate and connect to the Hubble telescope. So that is something that's really crazy, right? So that's the kind of stuff I'm looking forward to doing.
Yeah, I think a lot of things along that line, giving kids and adults the ability to not just view, but actually interact with people from whether it's an author or people in science. They can ask questions and participate in things that are just not available in their immediate communities.
I think we are out of time.
Right, okay.
So thank you, everyone.
Thank you.